And thank you for tuning in to Poly Live.
I'm Caitlin.
And I'm Scott. And once again, we are coming at you live from the Dexter Art Gallery. Today we have two wonderful moderators here to answer your questions live during the show. That is Ashley and Laura. So if at any time you have a question, just type it in. We will answer it. They might even relay the question to us and we can answer the question with our guests. Also, I'd like to help you view us better because what is this show without viewing us, right? So go ahead and find the grayscale drop-down menu. Click the grayscale drop-down menu, and it goes down to fine color. And then also if you go view, layout, wide layout, we should be looking real pretty across your screen. So yeah, I have a surprise for you. Actually, it's not a surprise. It's really unfortunate. Today's our last show together.
I know, I'm really, really sad.
It's been a really wonderful summer working with Caitlin, and this is our sixth and final episode of the summer. So what do you have going on for the rest of the summer?
Well, I'm going camping tonight.
Oh, that's sudden.
Yeah. I'm going to Lopez Lake. Hanging out with friends. School starts soon, so I need to fit everything in before school starts.
Yeah, 2 weeks.
What about you?
I recently built a boat with my friends. It's some people try to call it a raft to bring me down, but no, it's definitely a boat. It's a mini pontoon boat. It's the style of construction. Anyway, so I will be tanning on that in the ocean.
Well, we have a great show for you today. We have the men's soccer team here. Get excited. It's really, really great to have the head coach, Paul Holliher, and second year forward, Matt LaGrassa, here with us today. We also have guests from University Housing to get all your questions answered about move-in day and what it's like to live in the residence halls. So look out for that, and you will definitely enjoy some of our awesome commercials coming up in just a sec. See you after the break.
Hey everyone, my name is Justin, and I'm going to be doing some occasional videos throughout the show, so you might see me a little bit more. But today, I'm here in San Luis Obispo at Cal Poly, and we're going to go ahead and look at the Summer Orientation Program, or SOAR. And so hopefully you guys have signed up for it, but we're going to go check it out and hopefully get a couple interviews, and we'll see what's going on. All right? I'm here with Andrew, and he's one of the SOAR leaders here at Cal Poly. And so, why is it important to come to SOAR?
Well, first of all, SOAR is just a lot of fun. You get to hang out with a bunch of people, cool people like me, like Justin. It's going to be great. And you get to see a lot of cool presentations. It's fun.
And what should new students and parents expect when they come here to Cal Poly?
Okay, so much. You get to go downtown. You get to explore downtown. You'll get multiple very in-depth campus tours. You'll see informative presentations on topics like time management, signing up for classes, alcohol awareness. You get to just have fun, hang out with new students. You get to explore our brand new rec center. Only been open a few months. It's wonderful. You'll get to go there for the day. It's fantastic.
All right. Thank you very much. So what's the favorite thing you've learned today or something informative that you'd like to tell all the new students about?
Just the hands-on program here. It can't be beat. That's why I chose here. I had a lot of other choices, but Cal Poly, the program is phenomenal and the teachers are too.
So what's the thing you're looking forward to about being a Mustang or exploring downtown, for example?
Just making new friends, having fun, and learning.
All right, sounds good. So I heard you got a little talent that you could show us.
Yeah, I do rap. I record, so we're going to lay down something. We're going to have fun.
All right. You guys want to come in here? All right. Here you go.
Okay, we ready?
Can I rock to this rhyme? You're not on my mind. They say we blowing up, so don't jump on the mine. There once was a time to the world I was blind. Now I see everything through these contacts of mine.
And here we have...
Ellen Baragimian.
And where are you from?
Oak Park, California.
Okay, so how's SOAR going for you today?
It's been great. The weather's been beautiful, the school is amazing, and it's been really informative.
What's the most important thing that you think you've learned today?
All the questions that, as a new parent, first-time kid going to college, they've answered all my questions, so I feel relieved and comfortable having him go off for the first time.
Hey guys, so we're downtown at Mitchell Park, and everyone just finished exploring SLOW. So here we have a couple people, and they're going to tell us about how their day's going. So what are your guys' names?
Will.
I'm Johnny.
Calvin.
Jared.
All right, so you guys just explored downtown. So what did you guys do downtown?
I went over to Firestone and got an awesome tri-tip sandwich.
We just walked around and ate, and it was pretty fun.
Yeah, we went to a SLOW Brewing Company, and we got some sandwiches. They were pretty good.
Nice. Hung out with these cool kids.
All right, so what's like the most important thing that you've learned so far about like Cal Poly during the SOAR program?
Probably having good time management and learning how to study and go out and play.
Okay. Just learning about all the clubs and opportunities on campus to help you like be better and be a better student.
Yeah, I wasn't aware of the resources available to students before, so SOAR helped me become aware of them.
Yeah, and like not like, to go out of your comfort zone and like meet new people and join clubs.
All right, sounds good. So there you have it. There's all these new students exploring SLOW, and they're about to get on the bus and go back to campus and learn some new stuff. Hey guys, so we're here out on Dexter Lawn, and you're either going to be having lunch or dinner here, depending on which group you end up being in. But here we have someone who went through the SOAR program, and they're almost done for the day. So let's have your name.
Camille Joy.
So how was your SOAR day today?
It's been really awesome. The presentations and the tours, they're really great. I mean, just getting to know more about the college that I'll be attending this fall, it's an amazing experience.
What's one thing that you say you'd take away the most from today?
The many opportunities to interact with your future classmates. You know, you do plenty of group activities over the course of the day, and, you know, you get to know people and, you know.
I'm ripe, I'm raw, I'm all the above, a big enough heart to give a hater a hug. Shooting off with a grenade or a slug, still bees, honey bees designated by Buzz, what?
That was pretty awesome. So, we'll see you guys later. All right, there you have it, guys. We took a look at the SOAR program, and we got a couple firsthand accounts of what it's going to be like actually going through the program. And so far, it looks like it's going to be a pretty good time. So I hope you guys are all excited to come here to Cal Poly, and just get ready. It's going to be a great time.
All right, and welcome back. So that was Justin again with our SOAR recap. We had a great time with SOAR, and if you came, we like seeing you here. And we also have one more SOAR day coming up, which is our out-of-state day, which is on the move-in day, September 12th. And we'll actually hear more about move-in from housing later on during the show. But yeah, right now we have Matt Holliher. Sorry, I just got your names mixed up. Paul Holliher and Matt LaGrassa with the Cal Poly soccer team. How are you guys doing?
Good. How are you guys doing?
Doing well, doing well.
And your season has already started, right?
Yes.
So you've been practicing and everything?
Yes, definitely. Cool. We just had a game against San Jose State. We just played them this last weekend and won 3-1, which was great. And we play at home this weekend on Sunday.
Nice.
Yeah.
Who do you play this weekend?
Play Valparaiso, team from Indiana.
Nice. Mm-hmm. Very cool.
So soccer is a really, really, really huge sport that students like to watch here at Cal Poly. And so, Matt, what is the atmosphere of a soccer game at Cal Poly?
Like? Honestly, incredible. Like, unlike any other college atmosphere, we really get spoiled here. The fans love us, and the Santa Barbara game in particular is just amazing.
So, the Santa Barbara's our biggest rival in soccer,
yes,
right?
Yes, yes.
Yeah.
We usually sell out the stadium, and it gets pretty loud. Yeah.
What is it about the Santa Barbara game that is so great? Like, why does everyone want to come?
Well, in general, I mean, it's a pretty big deal because this man, really, he kind of got the community involved and kind of created the rivalry. And I don't know, people just started coming, and we've sold out the stadium multiple times now, so it's a fun game.
Well, I mean, they're just down the road. They're about an hour and 15 minutes away. It's a Central Coast rivalry, and there's no love loss between the two schools. You know, and a lot of the students, I'm sure, you know, either applied to UC Santa Barbara and Cal Poly or one or the other, and so it's very heated. 11,000 plus people in the stadium, and it's just rocking. It's incredible.
We've also broken national attendance records, right?
Yeah.
So I guess what was your coming in? You came in 2006.
I did.
Yeah. So what was maybe your plan for fan and community involvement?
Well, you know, the idea was to create an atmosphere kind of like in Europe, you know, or in South America, where the fans are cheering and they're singing songs and they've got the scarves. So we've been watching this on TV for years and years. But in America, I mean, it's the number one sport in America now, playing soccer, and almost everybody on campus at some point has played soccer, and they can identify with it. So we wanted to create that fun atmosphere, and we also have a great community as well. So we have a lot of families coming out, students coming out, and it's in a beautiful stadium. So they're a lot of fun.
That's great. And we've had some student athletes that have become professional athletes, correct?
Yeah. Absolutely. We started recruiting, in 2006, and our first graduating class, produced guys that went on to Major League Soccer. We actually had a guy, Anton Peterlin, that got signed in the English Premier League with Everton.
Wow.
So that's part of the goal as well. I mean, you're looking at some guys that are future professional players, and, you know, this guy right here included, hopefully, in a few years.
Oh. Very cool. So, I guess, talking about you, you said you're a sophomore and you're a forward, so fans can maybe expect a younger Cal Poly team this year. Any word on that?
We're really young. We've got a lot of either redshirt freshmen or freshmen that have got a lot of good minutes already. But I think what we lack in experience, we really make up for in, like, tenacity. We're really hungry, really hungry group, and we're talented and hungry, and that's a good combination to have.
Nice. So you mentioned a soccer fan club that we have here. Do you want to talk a little bit about that?
Yes, the Manglers, which are very specific to the soccer team, unlike the Mustang Maniacs, and they're just a crazy group of people. They are a lot of fun. They know all of our chants that they've kind of created themselves. They have t-shirts, and they really drive the atmosphere at our games. So
started off with, like, our first year here started off with about five to ten guys, and they wanted to, sing songs and razz the other team and all that stuff. We said, all right, go for it, fellas. And, every game that group grew and grew and grew and grew, and now really you see thousands of people on campus with the Mangler shirts, and it's kind of taken a life of its own. So, but it's great.
That's
great.
Awesome.
Gets in the other team's head. Yeah. And it's brings a lot of fun to the game.
Yeah, and they just have their own chants and come and sing. And
absolutely.
It's great. Yeah.
Absolutely.
I've been to several of the soccer games, and there's just a huge section of the Manglers, so it's really fun.
So who are some maybe, like, some big names to look out for on the Cal Poly soccer team?
Well, like Maddie said, we're a young team, so these are guys that are all kind of getting their first bit of experience. Maddie's definitely a guy that you're going to see in the midfield. We have another guy, young guy, Steve Palacios, who's a very, very good player. Your brother went to high school with him. We have a forward named Mac Pridham, who's been scoring goals all spring, and is a guy that we feel is going to be a good producer for us. And, there's a number of guys.
Yeah.
For us, really, I don't know if it's one superstar guy rather than a bunch of great team guys. And I think the fans also are going to love how we play and how we move the ball and how we pass the ball.
Now, what is some of your coaching and teaching philosophies and styles?
I idolize the FC Barcelona. I love how they play. It's a team in Spain that's kind of dominated world soccer the last 6 years. And they have a beautiful game of soccer where they pass the ball very, very well. They kind of keep possession of the ball. It's not kind of a kick and run game, which you see a lot in college. Mm-hmm. We would rather dominate the game in possession of the ball. And so that's what we try to do. And I think we pass the ball probably better than most college teams. And I think the fans appreciate that.
Now, after incoming students move in, which is only in a couple weeks, what games are coming up that they should look forward to?
We got some great games. I'd say we got Valpo this weekend on Sunday, September 9th. And then next weekend, we play Temple and Army, the 14th and 16th. And then the following weekend, on September 21st and 23rd, when all the students are in, we have huge games. We play Harvard and we play UCLA. And both those games will have, you know, thousands and thousands of people, 8,000, 9,000 people at those games. So that'll be a big one for the campus.
And then when's the Santa Barbara game?
November 3rd.
November 3rd.
It's a home one here. It's a Saturday night. So it should be a fun one, definitely.
I think the whole campus comes to that one. And I've already heard people are coming from Hawaii and Arizona and coming from out of state to come watch it. It's just a phenomenal experience.
Yeah. That should be pretty heavily advertised then, right?
Yeah. I don't even know if we need to advertise it anymore, but it's really the number one rivalry in the nation. So it's fun.
So Matt, what is your favorite part about being at Cal Poly?
I chose this school for a number of reasons, really. I mean, I love the school, the area, but I mean, looking at the soccer program in general, I mean, the way that they play really drew me in, like with a passing style, something that I wanted to be a part of, opposed to like what a number of college students play like. And then the atmosphere, I mean, it's hard to ignore. A lot of people coming out to their games, which is fun. It's a great program. It's a great school. It's great everything.
And we tell our guys, too, that, you know, we do have a special thing here at Cal Poly because, you know, we are really, there's so much bond between the community and the students in the Central Coast. And when you go out there and you feel that energy from the crowd, I mean, it gives you, where you really are, have a huge advantage. And we're really, really just blessed to have the students here, so excited about the program.
So why should all of our incoming students come to your games?
I'm a little biased, but they're fun. I mean, they really are fun. The atmosphere, you can feel it. It's an energy, and people are standing and jump up and down. And one thing that adds to it is we play exciting soccer, I think. We're attacking brand football. We want to really score a lot of goals and entertain the fans. That's what we're looking to do. So, I mean, that's good enough reason for me.
Well said. I like that. So, yeah, soccer games are a great way to hang out with your friends, maybe ones that you met in your residence halls, and come cheer for green and gold. Yeah.
All year long. And the Santa Barbara game, make sure, if you don't go any games, you have to go to that one, because it's so much fun.
I agree.
Thank you so much for being here today.
Thank you for having us.
Yeah, of course. And we'll definitely be seeing you on the field and at the games.
Thank you guys.
So now we're actually going to be going into another commercial break, but we'll see you in a few minutes.
Now this is a story all about how my life got flipped, turned upside down. And I'd like to take a minute, just sit right there and tell you how I became known as the Prince of Fresh Air.
Yeah, with the heat coat, Prince of Fresh Air, woo.
In Fresno, California, I was born and raised. It's hot and a lot of the time we have bad air days. Wheezing while breathing, asthma ain't cool. We had more and more inhalers at our school. Then a couple of park rangers that were up to some good told us about this great place called the woods. The light went off and I decided right there that I was gonna become the Prince of Fresh Air.
Yeah, breathe it in, baby. The Prince is here. Eat cold. Lego.
I whistled for a hybrid, and when it came near, the license plate said Eco, had peace signs in the mirror. If anything, I could say that this hybrid was rare, but I thought, nah, forget it, your home's the fresh air. I pulled up to the lake about 7 or 8, and I yelled to Fresno, badass, smell you later. I looked at my kingdom, I was finally there, to sit on my throne as the Prince of Fresh Air.
Hey everyone, welcome back from the break. You just saw another music video by the infamous Mr. Ego. He's gonna save the world.
He is, one rap at a time.
Well, we have two new guests with us today from University Housing. We have Tessa Stevens, who is our outreach and program coordinator for University Housing. And we have Sarah Fernandez, who is a CSD, which is a coordinator of student development for Sierra Madre this year, right? Awesome. Well, thanks for being with us today.
Thanks for having us.
Let's get right into the nitty gritty. So we have move-in day coming up. And I know that there's, you know, 4,000 people out there or more, because their parents included, that are thinking about, like, how is that going to work? So what can they expect on move-in day?
Well, move-in day can be chaotic, but it could also be more relaxed if you take some of our tips and tricks to heart. We suggest not arriving early, so obviously we have listed online that move-in starts as early as 8 a.m., but we always recommend that students and families arrive a little bit later. You don't all have to arrive at 8 a.m. because I think everybody has that same idea, so the line can be out the door even by 7:30. A lot of students think, I'm going to get there first, and I'm going to stake my claim on my bed and get my side of the room, and often it's not really that important, especially if they touch base with their roommate in advance. So we just recommend waking up, having continental breakfast, relaxing, maybe arriving a little bit later. We suggest also before moving in or before even arriving onto campus to print out the move-in map, because there's a unique way to drive onto campus on move-in day. So I'm not sure if anybody has asked about this yet, but if you are scheduled to move into Sierra Madre or Yosemite, for example, you would arrive onto campus on Grand Avenue. But if you're scheduled to move into one of the Redbricks or Cerro Vista, you would arrive on Highland. So there's different ways to drive in onto campus. And fortunately, on move-in day, we have a shuttle so that once you do drive up as close as you can get to your residence hall, you can unload all your items on the curb and then go and park in a remote parking lot, which we have maps, you know, you can print out online of where that's located. And then we have a shuttle running every 15 or 20 minutes to take you back up to the residence hall. So that alleviates some of the traffic congestion.
That's really convenient.
Yeah. So
that's awesome.
We recommend, you know, wearing comfortable shoes, bringing a dolly, anticipating, you know, carrying your loads up to the room, and just be prepared for a lot of meeting and greeting with a lot of different people. You'll meet your CSDs. And one other thing too, a lot of parents are wondering if on move-in day, if they have to attend the parent information session. There's a parent information session at 1 o'clock and there's a session at 2. And it's not imperative. If you can't make it to either of those sessions, that's totally fine. The CSDs will gladly give you a little booklet to go over. But if you are able to attend that, there are two separate identical sessions at 1 o'clock and 2 o'clock on move-in day that the parents can participate in. So it's a really fun day. I always say within the first 5 minutes, you meet your lifelong friends. There's just a lot of activity and a lot of fun stuff happening.
Definitely. Thanks for that insight.
And we actually already have some questions coming in live on our feed. So a mom actually in our chat has a daughter moving into a triple. So I'm assuming one of the red bricks. Actually, is there triples in Yosemite and Sierra Madre as well?
Yes.
This year?
There are triples in all of the red bricks and all the two connections buildings. We do have a fair number of triples.
Okay.
I mean, there's plenty of space. We provide desks and dressers and closets for everyone, so everyone has that space. What we do recommend is that you don't bring an overwhelming amount of stuff when you move in. You know, bring the essentials, and then once you move in and you unpack, if you can bring more things later, if you still have the space, then that's what you should do. But try not to bring like huge pieces of furniture, any of that, because we provide all of those things for the students. Yep.
The same couple I'm almost to know, how many closets and dressers are in Yosemite?
Well, there'll be enough for the amount of people who are living there. So if there's two people assigned to the room, then they'll have furniture for two people. And if there's three people, then you know we make sure that everyone has their own desk and closet and dresser. Some of them are, you know, the built-in closets, and some of them are separate wardrobes. But we try to accommodate people who are in triples as much as possible.
Right. And then, is there a place for people to find the specific dimensions of the furniture that's going to be placed in there?
Yes. Yeah, if you go onto our housing website, which is housing.calpoly.edu, and go to, I think it's on-campus living, there's tabs across the top. If you click on-campus living and then go down to freshmen, there's a whole list of links there, but one of those first links will show all the different housing types and photos and room dimensions and interior photos and virtual tours, and there is a little PDF link there that says furniture dimensions and room dimensions, and that'll list out all of the furniture that's provided and exactly, you know, how much space is underneath the bed and how wide the closets are and how many drawers are provided, all the nitty-gritty details that parents and students want to know about.
And can you store things under the bed?
Yeah, actually, a lot of the residence halls have newer furniture, including the triple room. So going back to the triple room layout, a lot of the triple room, actually almost all of them, have brand new furniture where they've actually gutted out the built-in closets to make more square footage in the room and then to allow for new movable wardrobes. And the wardrobes are really tall, and you can open up two wardrobe doors, and then underneath there's, I think, two or three drawers underneath that belong to each student. And then there's a whole separate dresser that has several drawers, I believe. Are there
three
drawers?
Yeah, I think there's three drawers in each one.
And each student, even if it's double room or triple room, has a wardrobe and a dresser drawer. And a lot of the double rooms have beds, the newer furniture, the beds are actually already lofted up, mm-hmm. and then there's dressers underneath. So there's plenty of room underneath the bed to store your luggage, and it's just a nice improvement from the way that it used to be, where the beds were 6 inches off the ground and you couldn't put anything underneath. So now, you know, a common question is, can they loft the beds? And we don't allow that, but most of the beds are already lofted sufficiently. So you can put a whole bunch of stuff under the beds.
That's great. Better it sounds like space. The rooms are going to be a lot more roomy.
Yeah.
Which
yeah.
is really, really nice. So my nose is bleeding, has a question. And the question is, can you take a small record player into the halls, specifically Sarah Vista?
Yes, you can bring a record player, you can bring stereos, any of those things to play music. As long as you're not making too much sound and impacting people around you, you are welcome to bring all those things. We encourage people to make this their home, so we want them to bring the things that remind them of home, make them feel comfortable. This is their space, so they can bring any of those things, yep.
Are they like given quiet hours?
We do. Generally during the week after 10 p.m., we encourage people to be quieter. On the weekend, it's after midnight, but we have what we call 24-hour courtesy hours, so we encourage people to make sure that they are being courteous to those around them who might be sleeping or studying throughout the day.
So what do you suggest to a student if they're having conflicts with their roommates?
Yes. So this is a question we get a lot. And we have all of our RAs and CAs are trained in mediation, so they should definitely talk to their advisor as soon as possible. If they have things that are coming up, they can do everything from give advice on how to talk to their roommate about some of these issues to actually mediating the conflict with them. The CSDs are also trained in those things and can step in when necessary. What we do as a preventative, proactive measure is we have all of our rooms and apartments do roommate agreements at the beginning of the year, where the RA and CA we'll go in and talk to them about some of those challenging questions. We really push our students to have those difficult conversations early in an effort to prevent roommate conflicts later. So I would encourage residents to think about, you know, what it means to have guests over and what it means to be loud, when we turn the lights off, when our alarm goes off. All of those things that we may not think about right now are important, because those are the things that are gonna bother people later.
You mentioned guests. What is the policy on guests and visitors, and especially with minors or even like the security with outsiders?
So all of our buildings are locked 24 hours a day. So unless you live in that community, you aren't allowed access into it. So if you are a resident of a certain community and you have a guest who is not a Cal Poly student, everyone is required to fill out a guest registration form at the front desk. And then the guest has to be accompanied by the host of that community at all times. So we really don't allow people to just be wandering around aimlessly, things like that. And the host of the guest will be responsible for any actions of that particular guest. In terms of minors, we do have a new policy where anyone under the age of 18 who is not a Cal Poly student, in addition to the guest form, has to fill out a minor application form, which basically says that they have permission from their parents or guardians to be here at Cal Poly and to stay in our residence hall at the time. Those minors still need to have some sort of identification, whether it's a driver's license, passport, anything like that. And then anyone under the age of 15 actually cannot stay in our residence halls unless they are accompanied by a parent or guardian at all times. And really all of these things are to make sure that people are safe. We don't want people to be here and to, you know, if heaven forbid there's a problem or a big emergency or something, we want to make sure that everyone's accounted for and we know where everyone is, and so that's why we have that.
Mm-hmm. So another common question is, what should residents do or students do if they see somebody that's really heavily intoxicated, mm-hmm. or there's a dangerous situation?
We definitely encourage students to contact their RA or CA or the police directly anytime they see any of those things. I know a lot of times people are scared that they might get in trouble if they call the police or anything like that, but really that's not our priority. Our priority is safety first, and so if anyone thinks that something's out of the ordinary or someone is in any type of danger, we want them to contact and get help as soon as possible, because there are a lot of people in place to be able to take care of those things. The CSDs will respond, we'll make sure that UPD is there if it's necessary. So we really want people to do that. All of the buildings have either an RA or CA who is on call every night, and the phone numbers for each of those communities will be given to the students when they move in. So if there's ever an emergency, they can call that phone number and someone will answer and respond.
Is theft a big issue in the residence halls? And what kind of advice could you give students that are worried about that?
Yeah. It's not a huge issue, but that doesn't mean that it never happens. So we really want people to be proactive with that too. You should always keep your room door locked. I know sometimes it's nice to like leave your door unlocked and not have to carry your key, but we really want people to always lock their doors and always carry their keys. Another reason why we have our doors locked at all times is we don't want anyone to just be able to get in and steal things. So, you know, we shouldn't be propping our outside doors or anything like that either. And if you are in a community lounge or anything, making sure that you're not leaving things unattended, because you could walk away to go to the restroom or walk away for a second and someone could take anything. And like I said, it doesn't happen too frequently, but it does happen every once in a while. So as long as you're being safe and keeping your things locked up, then chances are that it won't. Another big thing is bikes, and a lot of times people will leave their bikes unattended or unlocked, and so those will get stolen, and so we want to make sure that people are locking their bikes and registering them early so that that doesn't happen.
Lovely. And you're the program and outreach coordinator, so how do residents get involved in their hall?
Well, there's a lot of leadership opportunities in the halls, and honestly, again, I know Sarah's been answering all the questions, but she, as one of the primary leaders in the halls, knows a lot of the opportunities for students that I don't even know. But one way under my area that students can get involved is through the Housing Ambassador Program. And this is something that started up a couple years ago, and it's similar to the PolyReps in that housing has, we accommodate so many students that have that live on campus, and parents and families, especially prospective parents and families, are really curious about the on-campus housing programs and what we offer. So one area that I oversee is the Ambassador Program, where students can interview and be actually, once they are hired, they're actually part of our team until they graduate, and they do tours for our department. They show the residence halls every single day. We have a daily housing tour at 3 p.m. So right now we have, I think, over 50 student housing ambassadors that are part of our team, and if anybody's interested in getting involved with that, they can definitely come and talk to me. But I think within the residential life area, there's a lot of other leadership opportunities through hall council, and Sarah can elaborate on that, but the Housing Ambassador Program is a great way to get involved and sit at booths and answer questions about housing, or come to parent sessions and panels and answer questions, and of course the housing tours for various guests throughout the year.
Yeah, each community has their own hall or community council, which is essentially the student government for that particular community. So we really want students to get involved in that right away. That's their space to plan their own events, programs, to address any issues or anything that they may have noticed in the community. And we will have tons of information about that on move-in day, so the day that they get there, if they're excited. We encourage people who really enjoyed student government, ASB, things like that when they were in high school to come in and do that. There's lots of other things that come up throughout the year, so we want to make sure that people are reading their emails or things that the CSDs and housing sends them, because there's going to be opportunities that just pop up all the time. The other thing is that just attending programs and events and being involved as a way to just meet a lot of new people. We encourage our students to think about the things that they want to see happen in their community and work with their RAs and CAs to make those happen.
We have a question from our audience, and my nose is bleeding. Would like to know just generally about transportation, but what about parking? Where do residents park? Do you recommend bringing a bike? And then a little bit about the bus system and going downtown from the residence halls.
Yeah, we always encourage students, at least for their first quarter on campus, to consider not bringing a car. It's not, we always say, like, your classes are on campus, your friends are on campus, all your meals are on campus, you might have a part-time job on campus, your whole life is there. And so it's not as often that you or even your other fellow friends and your neighbors in the residence halls even want to go off campus. But if you do, inevitably there'll be somebody with a car.
But we always consider leaving your car at home just to test it out. Bring a bike for sure and register it with UPD and make sure you lock it up, of course. But it's a great campus and a great city to ride bikes around. And I love the bus. When I was a Cal Poly student, I rode the bus all the time. Even when I lived off campus, I rode the bus because it's free for Cal Poly students. And you can get around town easily. You can get dropped off downtown at Farmers Market. You can go to the other side of town and go shopping. The bus will take you to the Amtrak station if you want to hitch a train or a ride home. A lot of times students will have a ride share board posted online too, and I think it's online through the ASI classified section, but you can collaborate and communicate with other students in your hall and you'll meet people that are from your area. You'll say, I'm from the Bay Area too, or I'm from the Sacramento area. Are you going home for Thanksgiving? Can I get a ride? I'll pay for gas, or I'll bring treats in the car. And you know, it's a good way to just get a group together and save on gas money, but it's an added expense for sure to get a parking permit for the year. I think, don't quote me on it, but I think it's over $530 for an academic year parking permit. One thing that's different about where students can park this year is that the lots are not going to be designated for the specific halls. In the past, students in red brick halls had to park their car further away than was even convenient. So one thing, if you are bringing a car, you will be able to park your car a little bit closer. All of the resident parking lots are going to be up for grabs for students. So if they live in Trinity or Fremont or a residence hall that's a little bit closer to where they live, they will be able to park in those lots that are a little bit closer conveniently. So that's a change.
Great. And for getting home, there's actually an Amtrak stop located right across from Sierra Madre, right, for students to take the train home if they wish.
Yeah, it's a really popular option. The bus, the Amtrak bus will pick you up on campus and drive you to the Amtrak station, and then they'll take the train home. It's fun.
It's awesome. So busing downtown is just easy, it sounds like.
Yeah.
Well, I'm not, like, I don't know. Yes, I use it all the time.
Yeah. So. But even if you, once they move off campus, you know, their third or fourth year, busing from anywhere that you live in the community onto campus is sometimes even faster than driving onto campus and parking far away and then walking into your class, because the bus stops on campus are conveniently located in the heart of the campus where a lot of the academic classes are held, and students can hop off the bus and be in their classroom, in their seat, faster than they could if they were to drive. So it saves money and time.
Yeah, definitely. Can you walk from the residence halls to classes, or does that take too long?
You can definitely walk from the residence halls to classes. And like Tessa said, even if you wanted to take the bus from one side of campus to the other, that's an option. I don't think it takes too long. People ride bikes back and forth. But you don't need to drive across campus to get to class, because I do think that it probably would take longer by the time you found a parking spot and then walked from the parking lot to class. The other nice thing is that in your residence hall, especially for the first years, most of them are going to be taking the same classes as you, and so everyone would walk together and get there together.
Great, well thank you for coming. We've had a good time and you've answered some great questions for our audience. We're going to go ahead and cut to a commercial break now. And so now, check out what you have in store if you do WOW.
And largest traditions is the Week of Welcome Orientation Program. This unique program runs the week before classes begin in the fall.
During this program, new students are placed into groups within their residence halls or with other transfer students. The groups are led by two trained orientation leaders.
Students to San Luis Obispo and Cal Poly's campus. There are also additional presentations and events to encourage students to meet new people and to learn about the new responsibilities of being a Cal Poly student.
WOW helped me transition to my new home.
Welcome to Cal Poly's
explore San Luis Obispo,
and become a Cal Poly Mustang with WOW.
Caitlin? Hey. Hey, champ. What you doing? You okay?
It's our last show. I'm just really sad.
Oh, Caitlin. This isn't the end of us. You know, we'll be together for a long time. Hold my hand. There we go. We've had a wonderful time, and we're very emotionally attached to this show. And it's sad to go, but it's got to happen, you know?
But are we ending forever?
No, but I'm glad you asked. So, this is the last of the summer, but PolyLive will be back in the first week of October. Look out. If you like us on Facebook, you can get the updates. We're going to have two brand new hosts, and we're going to be covering wonderful topics about everything that you'll be living through. So rather than thinking about what's in store, you're going to be like, I'm doing this. So it'll be great.
So... please feel free to like our Facebook page and send us any more questions if you have any. And we really, really hope you enjoyed this season. I know that we did. Yeah. So it's been a great ride.
I'd like to give a special thank you to Justin, our correspondent, who's put together some awesome videos for us. And he'll actually be continuing his work with PolyLive throughout the school year. So go ahead and send any questions that you have to orientation@calpoly.edu. Like us on Facebook at facebook.com/cpslowpolylive. And in the meantime, we will see you in October.
We'll see you in a week, actually. Out-of-state students move in on the 12th, and then there's WOW. So yeah. We'll see you very soon.
Get excited. We're going to get up a second and give a time to celebrate everyone behind the cameras. So here we come.
We're coming.
We're coming at you. Oh, my. Oh, equipment. Hey, these are your moderators. And they're running the show. There's so many people.
Say hi, everyone. Say hi.
Hi.
Audio works, too. All right. Well, that is it for this season of Poly Live. We will see you back sometime in October. Peace.
Bye, everyone.
Yeah. This is...